I'm sure you've heard at least a few times in your life about how much tech that are in our phones today started at NASA. And today we're going to be talking about one of the most valuable parts that we use every day, and that's our cameras. Hey everybody, welcome back to I Need More Space, a show brought to you by a guy who loves taking pictures with his dog.
Oh, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you, you're the best thing ever, oh my god, oh my god.
Oh my god, he needs to be in the show more. Why has he not been in the show more? So yeah, today we're going to be talking about the cameras that are on our phones, more specifically the sensors that we use in our phones, and how NASA is involved with that. Just a quick disclaimer for today's video, I am not an electrical engineer, and when I read these articles, there's a lot of words that are just way above my reading level, but three things I do know are characters, story, and cool tech. So let's just jump into it. So at the top of this video, you basically need to know that there are two main image sensors used in camera technology, CCDs and CMOS. CCD stands for charged coupled device, and CMOS stands for complementary metal oxide semiconductor. Both horribly boring titles, so we're just gonna stick with CCD and CMOS. CCD are basically the oldest digital camera technology we have around. It was developed in the 60s. The guys who made it won a Nobel Prize. It was the first time we actually take light and convert it into electrons so that we can read it on a computer, which is just The main drawback to CCD, though, is that they require a lot of energy to use, and they also are pretty large in size. They take very good pictures, but they really just weren't practical for consumer use, and they were also very expensive. With the invention of this technology, NASA embraced it, and they started putting CCDs in all their satellites that required cameras. Parallel to all this happening, there was also research being done on a different kind of sensor. There's this guy named Frank Wanless, and he was doing a lot of research and development for microprocessors, and he developed a process called CMOS. This is a really dumbed down version of CMOS, but basically allows for microprocessors to process information using less electricity, I think. But it just basically has to know it's smaller and fast. Nearly 30 years later, a guy named Eric Fossum, who worked for Jet Propulsion Laboratories of NASA, started looking into CMOS and seeing how it could be applied to image sensors. You see, there are two major enemies for spaceflight, and that is weight and energy. NASA and other space agencies are constantly trying to figure out how to make their payloads lighter and also use less energy. JPL's mandate at the time was to try to develop technology that uses less energy and is cheaper, and CMOS looked to be a valid option. Eric had the bright idea of taking the back end of CMOS, which is able to process information but using less energy, and applying an active pixel sensor. Did I say that right? Yes, active pixel sensor, which then takes said light and sends it through the CMOS processor, thus converting light into electrons. Am I doing that right? I keep saying electrons just because that's information that computers can read and turn into an image. Today you'll see CMOS sensors in pretty much every consumer grade and professional grade camera. It's rare that you see a CCD anymore that you can buy off the shelf, just because they still use a lot of power and they're pretty large in size. NASA though still embraces the CCD. Astronomers are huge fans of it just because of its picture quality, and they don't really need to worry about energy. Satellites like Kepler and Hubble currently have CCDs on board for their images, and the James Webb Space Telescope is going to have a wide array of CCDs. It's a huge satellite, and its primary goal is to take high quality images. So yeah, naturally NASA wants CCDs on board that satellite in order to make their investment worthwhile. NASA is using CMOS sensors clearly on board the International Space Station because it's filled with DSLRs and they all have CMOS sensors, but also in microsatellites. Microsatellites usually have a short mission time, and they need to be light, and they need to be cheap to build. NASA and other companies want to build them to scale and be able to deploy them all over the place, so CMOS sensors just make the most sense because they don't use a lot of power, and microsatellites cannot generate a whole lot of power. And two, they're a lot cheaper than CCD chips, so when you need to make a lot of them, go the cheaper route. When it comes to CMOS video though, it does have one Achilles heel, and that is rolling shutter. It's basically when you turn the camera really fast or something's moving fast in the frame and you see all these squiggly lines. I'm gonna reference a video from Smarter Every Day. Hey Destin, he explains it way more than I could have explained it, and I recommend you go watch his video. He does a really good job explaining the difference of rolling versus global shutter. Okay, well that's it. Now you know that you have a little piece of space tech walking around in your pocket with you every day. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please like and subscribe and comment if you have any thoughts. I'm loving what folks are saying so far, and if you don't like this video, feel free to dislike it, but if you dislike it, just tell me why you didn't like it so I can improve my videos for the future. Alright, thanks a lot for watching, and have a great day.
Boy, you were really meant for this, weren't you, huh? Oh, you're your man, little man.